Today's tech tip video demonstrates the steps involved in splitting adherent cell lines. I'm Gina, Research Associate at Cell Signaling Technology, and this is CST Tech Tips. This is the third tech tip video covering splitting cells. If you missed our previous tech tip video on the importance of splitting cells for healthy cell cultures, watch it first by clicking the pop-up link in the corner and then come back to this video. If you need to split non-adherent cell lines, click the second pop-up link for that video. Compared to the protocol for splitting suspension cell lines, additional steps are required to dissociate adherent cells from the surface of the vessel, so that's what we will focus on today. There are a few methods to do this. Some cell lines, such as MCF10A and RA264.7, need to be physically detached using a cell scraper. This should be done gently using good sterile technique. On the other hand, some lightly adherent cell lines, such as epithelial cells, can be dissociated using EDTA, which disrupts integrins. Most adherent cell lines are more strongly adherent and need to be enzymatically dissociated using the protease trypsin, which we will demonstrate next. Trypsin and EDTA are sometimes used together, and there are other alternative methods for dissociation as well. We recommend that you check with the supplier of your cell line to find the recommended method for dissociating cells. Okay, let's demonstrate the trypsin dissociation method. After inspecting your cells to confirm they've reached the desired density, place a bottle of media, PBS, and trypsin in a warm bath. Aspirate the old media from the dish and rinse with 1x PBS to remove soluble protein that can reduce proteolytic activity of trypsin. Aspirate off the 1x PBS. Add enough warm trypsin solution to coat the cells following the manufacturer's recommendation based on the surface area of the cell culture vessel. For example, 2 mL of trypsin is typical for a plate with an area of 15 square centimeters. Place the dish with the trypsin in the incubator at 37 degrees. The time required to detach cells from the surface can vary from about 1 minute to a few minutes, depending on the cell line. Using the microscope, check if the cells are lifting off the surface. If not, you may return them to the incubator for a brief time before checking again. In general, we do not use mechanical agitation such as pipetting the trypsin or tapping or shaking the flask or dish. Once you observe the cells detaching and lifting from the surface, the trypsin needs to be neutralized. This can be done by adding media containing serum. Generally, you should add at least twice the initial volume of trypsin. So for our example of 2 mL of trypsin, add double the volume or 4 mL of media with serum. For cell lines that require serum-free media, trypsin is instead removed by spinning down the cell suspension, followed by aspirating the supernatant. Then the cell pellet can be resuspended in fresh cell culture media. Pipette the cells up and down several times. The goal here is to ensure a single cell suspension. As a reminder, pipette carefully at all times, but especially when resuspending a cell suspension, and avoid jarring liquid into the filter or pipettate body. You can check for a single cell suspension by removing a small volume for observation with the microscope. If you still see cells stuck together, pipette the suspension further until you see mostly single cells. Once you have a single cell suspension, you may perform a cell count. Pipette the cell suspension up and down again immediately before transferring to ensure an accurate cell count. Refer to our blog for guidance on counting cells with automated counters or manually with a hemocytometer. We'll leave a link to the blog below this video. Determine the volume of resuspended cells to seed in each vessel based on the density obtained in the cell count. Pipette the suspension one more time to ensure a uniform distribution immediately before dispensing in new cell culture vessels. Then add warmed culture media to each vessel to bring the final volume up to the recommended volume per surface area, and tilt the dish a few times to evenly distribute cells across the surface of the vessel. Label the newly seeded vessel with the cell line, date, and passage number, and place in the incubator. Why is it good practice to track the number of times cells have been split? After a finite number of divisions, non-transformed cells exit the cell cycle and become senescent. This can affect not only your ability to propagate cells, but also how cells respond to experimental stimuli. To learn more about senescence, check out our tech tips video by clicking the pop-up link in the corner. One final tip on maintaining cell lines is related to reproducibility. Even if you take care to label everything and use good sterile technique, mistakes sometimes happen. Cell lines can become misidentified or cross-contaminated either with other cell lines or the dreaded mycoplasma contamination. Any of these could negatively affect your data and experimental reproducibility. Fortunately for many lines, it is possible to check if misidentification has occurred by using short tandem repeat or STR profiling. To learn more, read our blog post on STR profiling. We'll include a link below. That wraps it up for this video. If you found any of these tips helpful, hit the like and share buttons to help your fellow scientists find this video, and subscribe to our channel. If you have a question about a CST antibody kit or product, you can always get in touch with our scientist at cellsignal.com/support. Thanks for watching, and good luck with your experiments.